it. That's the humor in this one, right? You missed it. Went right over your head. Sorry. I've titled this last lecture, The Journey Through Dialogue to Inner Peace. There is no word for what I love in you, but it is sure, sacred, and daily as bread. I speak by indirections of a world divisible as loaves among ourselves and multiplied like miracles because we share the private tables of the mind. We join in rites and sacraments that bind and keep us bound like vows when we face God or Plato over coffee, books, and smoke. Discovering the truth we always knew, we look in one another's eyes to what we shall recall 5 years from now, reclining on a plane, exchanging socks in Macy's, surrendering to pain, dying, or saddle-blocked before birth. These lines written by Samuel Hazo in a poem entitled For My Last Class of Freshmen speak to me, and I hope to you, about the journey each of us takes as a teacher student, a journey whose mode is dialogue and whose destination is inner peace. I have always considered my choice of academic study a wise choice, but never more so than tonight, when I must somehow convey to you what I want you most to remember about what I've taught and learned and how I've tried to practice what I've preached. For you see, communication begins with dialogue, and dialogue is the means by which we take our educational journey, a journey often sidetracked by obstacles or tangential concerns, but a journey that, if continued, can lead us to a unifying theme for our lives, a theme that can provide us with a sense of inner peace. 25 years ago, while studying for my PhD, I was led to read a book by Paulo Freire, a Brazilian exile who devoted his life to educating the impoverished and oppressed in third world countries. In his book, Pedagogy of the Oppressed, he wrote, "There is no path other than dialogue. Without dialogue, there is no communication, and without communication, there can be no education." Dialogue is the loving encounter of people who, mediated by the world, proclaim that world. They transform that world, and in transforming it, humanize it for themselves and for all people. In the next few minutes, I would like to share with you what I know to be the components of the dialogue and to describe the journey which you have all begun that will enable you to develop a unifying theme for your life, a theme that will provide for you, as it has for me, a sense of inner peace. The dialogue. Dialogue is the basic form of communication. We carry on the dialogue intrapersonally. We know this better as talking to ourselves, and the students in the audience recognize it as something that we aging professors are found doing frequently. Or we can carry it out person to person or person to persons in a process that leads to shared meaning and hopefully mutual understanding. Knowledge, said Freire, is built upon the relations between human beings and the world, relations of transformation. Liberating education and authentic communication are two sides of the same coin. My first experience with dialogue occurred 42 years ago in the fall of 1955. In a course called Masterpieces of World Literature. My math is not off. This is 1997, and I am, as usual, in a different time and place from most of the people who are listening to me. I was a freshman in the Masterpieces of World Literature course, and the instructor, who was chairperson of the English department at Muskingum College, explained to us the first day of the semester that the progress of our learning would depend solely on our ability to ask the penetrating questions that reading these masterpieces would provoke in us. If we came to class without questions, he said, there would be no lecture. We would, instead, spend the 50 minutes in silent reflection on the material we had read, and we should all hope that in the process of reflection, we would be led to questions. And thus did the semester progress. And thereby did I begin to develop my profound love for literature and my deep appreciation of dialogue as the process by which each of us could teach and learn. Such dialogue is difficult but attainable. Says Frere, founding itself upon love, humility, and faith, dialogue becomes a horizontal relationship of which mutual trust between the dialoguers is the logical consequence. Teaching and learning through dialogue is much different from other styles of teaching and learning. The teacher-student, either the one behind the podium or the one at the desk, uses dialogue as a tool for learning and teaching. The teacher-student at the podium who uses dialogue must ask herself what she will dialogue with students about, and preoccupation with the content of the dialogue is really the program and content of education. Learning becomes a shared experience. The anti-dialogical educator, on the other hand, views the question of content only from her own perspective of what she will lecture to the students about, and thus she answers only her own questions. Frere calls this the banking system of education. Education thus becomes an act of depositing, in which students are depositories and the teacher the depositor. Instead of communicating, the teacher issues communiques and makes deposits, which the students patiently or impatiently receive, memorize, and repeat. The scope of action allowed to the students extends only as far as receiving, filing, storing, or at times regurgitating the deposits. Eventually, the personhood of the student atrophies through the lack of creativity, transformation, and the shared experience of learning. The difference between knowing and teaching is communicating. Perhaps many of you, including some of my colleagues here, consider this attitude of mine a pie-in-the-sky ideal. Perhaps the dialogue has worked for me because my field is communication, and my goal has been to have each student participate as fully as possible in the teaching-learning process. For me, the dialogue has been possible, and by it I have been enriched. For many, many years, my students have kept me up to date about pressing social issues through their well-researched presentations in public speaking and persuasion. I do believe, rightly or wrongly, that most students whom I have known have within them the potential to do well. They may lack the will, but the light is shining, however dimly. My task has been to fan the flame. As Albert Schweitzer once wrote, when people have light in themselves, it will shine out from them. Then we get to know each other as we walk together through the darkness without needing to pass our hands over others' faces or to intrude into each other's hearts. Now, what are some of the markers along the path that enable us to note our progress? I believe there are four. Self-understanding and appreciation. Other understanding and appreciation. Transformation of ourselves, others, and the world through our choices to change. And the discovery of a growing sense of inner peace. In preparing for this last lecture, I contacted several alumni who have learned with me in courses over the years. I asked them what they would like to hear me say if they were to hear me deliver my last lecture. And one of these students said, "Remind us that you have given us a glimpse of our possibilities for inner peace, that regardless of our mistakes, we can continue to play life to the end, that in the final analysis, each of us must become a teacher-student responsible for his or her own learning and continued growth." Another former dialoguer said, "Tell us that as we learn to love and value ourselves, we will learn to love and value others. And in each place in which we live or work or play, the world will become a richer, more nurturing context." So it appears that the dialogue continues, as does the journey. When does the journey end? When we die, perhaps. For me, I hope it continues for yet a little while. 10 years ago, on April 29, 1987, I broke a 33-year-old vow never to play the piano in a recital with an audience present. I was on Passavant Center stage with an audience of fellow performers, students, a few loyal colleagues, and several participants from Elder Hostel. I played a Beethoven Adagio and a Chopin Nocturne. I play them well. But more importantly, I played as my instructor had insisted that I play, which was right on through to the end. Regardless of your mistakes, play right on through to the end. They will remember. That's how the journey is. You walk right on through to the end. You cannot pause and mend each error. You walk right on through to the end. You learn from the mistakes, but you walk. You walk right through to the end. I hope that you will walk as I have walked, with a friend or two to engage in the dialogue with you. Now, you may ask, how do I really hope to be remembered? Mae Sarton, my favorite author, wrote in one of her marvelous journals, "I would like to believe when I die, I have given myself away like a tree that sows seeds every spring and never counts the loss. Because it is not loss. It is adding to future life. It is the tree's way of being. Strongly rooted, perhaps, but spilling out its treasure on the wind." And perhaps some of you are wondering how I will remember you. Sam Hazo tells us in the closing lines of the poem with which I began, "Let us dare life as lovers dare the dark, and learn less stubbornly than blinded Saul that light comes from within or not at all."